In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
According to St. Mark, the 16th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When the Sabbath was passed, Mary Magdalene and Mary the mother of James and Salome bought spices so that they might go and anoint him. And very early on the first day of the week, when the sun had risen, they went to the tomb. And they were saying to one another, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance of the tomb?" And looking up, they saw that the stone had been rolled back. It was very large. And entering the tomb, he saw a young man sitting on the right side, dressed in a white robe, and they were alarmed. And he said to them, "Do not be alarmed. You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified. He is risen, he is not here. See the place where they laid him. But go tell his disciples and Peter that he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him, just as he told you." And they went out and fled from the tomb, for trembling and astonishment had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Alleluia! Christ is risen!
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia!
Thank you.
We can do the opening sentences found on page 2 of the bulletin. All praise to God the Father,
who raised the Son in victory.
All praise to Jesus, God's Son, risen from the dead.
Our living and reigning King.
All praise to God the Holy Spirit,
who has worked in us the living hope of the resurrection.
The stone has been rolled away. Alleluia.
The crucified one is risen. Alleluia.
He has conquered death by the cross.
He has come out of the tomb.
Easter proves it. His every word and his every deed are absolute truth.
Every promise he has made, he will fulfill. He will restore his broken people. He will raise us and make us whole again.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and the rider he has thrown into the sea.
The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation.
Your right hand, O Lord, glorious in power, your right hand, O Lord, shatters the enemy.
You have led in your steadfast love the people whom you have redeemed. You have guided them by your strength to your holy abode.
You will bring them in and plant them on your own mountain, the place, O Lord, which you have made your abode.
The sanctuary, O Lord, which your hands have established, the Lord will reign forever and ever. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider he has thrown into the sea. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you overcame death and opened to us the gate of everlasting life. We humbly pray that we may live before you in righteousness and purity forever. Through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The congregation may be seated. As we gather early on this Easter morning, we're drawn back to that first Easter early in the morning, when the women walked to the tomb burdened by grief, hopelessness, and uncertainty. They would soon be awakened by the angel's presence and words, and the surprise of light and true light fell in the empty tomb. As Scripture still speaks to us today in our times of grief, hopelessness, and uncertainty, we also encounter the light of the true life of our Lord through his word, pointing to, centering on, and fulfilled in our Savior, Jesus Christ. In Exodus, we hear Israel cry out to the Lord for rescue. In 1 Corinthians, Paul reminds the people then and us now of Christ's resurrection witness by more than 500 people. In the Holy Gospel, we hear again how Mary Magdalene came in darkness to the tomb and found the surprise of the risen Savior. Our Old Testament reading is from Exodus chapters 14 and 15. When Pharaoh drew near, when the people of Israel lifted up their eyes, and behold, the Egyptians were marching right after them, and they feared greatly. And the people of Israel cried out to the Lord. They said to Moses, "Is it because there are no graves in Egypt that you have taken us away to die in the wilderness? What have you done to us and bring us out of Egypt? Is this not what we said to you in Egypt? Leave us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians. For it would have been better for us to serve the Egyptians than to die in the wilderness." And Moses said to the people, Fear not. Stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you have only to be silent. The Lord said to Moses, "Why do you cry to me? Tell the people of Israel to go forward. Lift up your staff and stretch out your hand over the sea and divide it, that the people of Israel may go through the sea on dry ground. And I will harden the hearts of the Egyptians, so that they shall go in after them. And I will get glory over Pharaoh and all his hosts, his chariots and his horsemen. And the Egyptians shall know that I am the Lord, when I have gotten glory over Pharaoh, his chariots and his horsemen." Then the angel of God, who was going before the host of Israel, moved and went behind them. And the pillar of cloud moved before them and stood behind them, coming in between the host of Egypt and the host of Israel. And there was a cloud in the darkness, and it lit up the night without one coming near the other all night. Then Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the Lord drove the sea back by a strong east wind all night and made the sea dry land. And the waters were divided. And the people of Israel went into the midst of the sea on dry ground, the waters being a wall to them on their right hand and on their left. The Egyptians pursued and went in after them into the midst of the sea, all Pharaoh's horses, his chariots, and his horsemen. And in the morning watch, the Lord in the pillar of fire and of cloud looked down on the Egyptian forces and threw the Egyptian forces into a panic, clogging their chariot wheels so that they drove heavily. And the Egyptians said, "Let us flee from before Israel, for the Lord fights for them and against the Egyptians." Then the Lord said to Moses, "Stretch out your hand over the sea, that the water may come back upon the Egyptians, upon their chariots, and upon their horsemen." So Moses stretched out his hand over the sea, and the sea returned to its normal course when the morning appeared. And as the Egyptians fled into it, the Lord threw the Egyptians into the midst of the sea. The waters returned and covered the chariots and the horsemen of all the hosts of Pharaoh that had followed them into the sea, not one remained. But the people of Israel walked on dry ground through the sea, the waters being a wall to them on the right hand and on their left. Thus the Lord saved Israel from the hand of the Egyptians. And Israel saw Egyptians dead on the seashore. Israel saw the great power of the Lord that the Lord used against the Egyptians, so that the people feared the Lord, and they believed in the Lord and in his servant Moses. Then Moses and the people of Israel sang the song of the Lord, saying, "I will sing to the Lord, for he has triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider he has thrown into the sea." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistles from the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. Now I would remind you, brothers, of the gospel I preached to you, which you received, in which you stand, by which you are being saved, if you hold fast to the word I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you as first importance what I also received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the Scriptures, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. They appeared to Cephas, then to the 12. Then he appeared to more than 500 brothers at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me, for I am the least of the apostles, unworthy to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace toward me was not in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We rise from the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 20th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we don't know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, followed him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in. And he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. And as she wept, she stooped to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had laid. One at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father, but go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "We have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
St. Paul writes, "If Christ had not been raised, your faith is futile, and you are still in your sins." Because of this, Easter morning delivers the joyous truth that Christ has been raised, and that God has made us his people through our baptism into Christ. Living together in trust and hope, we confess our faith in his work accomplished for us.
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead.
What does this mean?
I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father from all eternity, and also true man, born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord, who has redeemed the lost and condemned person, purchased and won me from all sins,
from death and from the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy precious blood, and with his innocent suffering and death, that I may be his own, and deliver again in his kingdom, and serve him in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness, just as he who comes from the dead, and lives and reigns to all eternity. This is most certainly true.
The congregation may be seated. If there are any young children that would like to come forward to the children's sermon, now is the time. Good morning. Good morning. I'm glad you're awake. Are you awake? Jesus woke up from the tomb, and so I'm sort of wide awake. That and coffee. Anyway, does anyone remember we had a children's sermon some of you were here for that was about 40 days ago, not counting Sundays. And we talked about a word that we don't say during Lent. Yeah? You think you remember it? A word we don't say during Lent. What's the word we don't? You know what? We hid it away, right? Yeah. Let's see what we have here. One moment. We hid it away in the baptismal font, right? Okay. Down here. Ugh. Okay. Hit it away. What's the word say? Alleluia, right? And so now we can say alleluia all we want, right? Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia! Woo! And why would we say alleluia like that? Because we're sad? Are we happy? Yeah, alleluia, because Jesus raised from the dead, right? And so now we can go, yay, like that, right? Woo, alleluia. In the waters of baptism, you know what? Jesus was raised from the dead, and you also raised from the dead. So we can party. Woo. Oops. Woo. Woo, party, party. Party, party! Oh! Woo! Woo! Party, party! Woo! I should not get these from Dollar General, I don't think. Anyway. Here we go. Party, party! Woo! Oops. Woo! Okay. Yeah, we can rejoice because Jesus was raised from the dead, and because Jesus was raised from the dead, when we get sad or angry or maybe we know people that are sad, we don't have to be sad because we know that in the end, God's good and it all works out. So let us pray. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
We thank you.
We thank you.
For sending Jesus.
For sending Jesus.
To forgive our sins.
To forgive our sins.
We thank you.
We thank you.
For raising him.
For raising him.
From the dead.
From the dead.
We thank you.
We thank you.
That we can say,
that we can say,
alleluia!
Alleluia!
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Take a piece of candy to share and one to eat. And actually, a small take a bunch of.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Our text is the Gospel from John. Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking? Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, Sir, if you had carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, and I will take him away. Jesus said to her, Mary. She turned and said to him in Aramaic, Rabboni, which means teacher. Please be seated. Death is difficult. Death is traumatic. Those of you who dealt with the loss of loved ones, you know what a roller coaster that can be. It is really just this constant churning of, oh my goodness, am I thinking the right things? Am I feeling the right things? How many death certificates do I need to get? What is a person going through? And it's really a difficult thing. And at the same time, there's this odd sense of calmness as well. Because the person who has died is at rest. The person who's died, their struggle is over. Their turmoil is over. And they are indeed calm and still. But it's difficult because we don't know what we should do. Some families, some people have the opportunity to be there when their loved one passes away. And it gets to be an interesting thing because you don't quite know, the person, how long should I stay? When should I leave? Once I leave the room, when will the funeral director, what will they do? You sort of, what's going on with the body at this point? And then there's a reassurance, perhaps, seeing the body at the cemetery or body at the funeral. There's others that can't make it there, and they wonder what's going on. Is grandma, grandpa, is she living? Is he dead? What's going on? Now this is sort of a downer kind of start of an Easter sermon, I realize. But that's what Mary was going through. Mary of Magdalene. Mary is one of Jesus' closest followers. Mary owed her life to Jesus. We don't know much about Mary except that she had 7 demons cast out. And what her life looked at, we don't know, but we know what demons do. And demons cause healthy bodies to become sick. Demons cause mental illness. Demon causes all sorts of spiritual ailments. Maybe Mary Magdalene was an addict. Maybe she had physical pains. Maybe she had just the sin she could not get beyond. Whatever it was, Mary was a troubled woman. And then she met Jesus. Jesus loved her as she was. Jesus saw her even with 7 demons and said, I'm here for you. I love you. Jesus did not reject her like so many others probably did. Jesus did not shame her, as probably so many others did. She was free to live a life of purpose. She was free to follow him, following this man who gave her life back, who gave her freedom, who gave her victory over sin during the course of her life, not completely, but victory during the course of her life. She was able to live a life of purpose, following him. And so Mary was there when Jesus died. She saw the blood. She saw the crown of thorns. She saw him hanging on the cross with the nail marks in his hands and in his feet. And it was the Sabbath, and she wanted to make sure that her beloved Savior, her beloved Lord, her beloved Rabbi was laid to rest properly. She had prepared the body herself. This wasn't just sending him away to a funeral director, sort of distant. She was there, and they brought spices, and they prepared the body, wrapped them, and they were going to finish up the process. And so one can imagine, early in the morning, the dread of going to see the person who rescued you, who saved you from sin, who saved you from a life of following the wrong things, and there all the hopes, the dreams, would be lying there in that tomb. Perhaps the stench would have started, and this is what Mary anticipated going to see. And so she gets there early, and things are not right. The stone that's supposed to be there isn't there. The soldiers who are supposed to be guarding the stone, the tomb, were not there. And so her heart rate probably quickened, and she's maybe frustrated, maybe angry. What's this foul play going on here? And we can imagine a lot of emotion. And so when it comes to fight, flight, or freeze, Mary fled. She ran and she told the disciples. And so Peter, Simon Peter gets there. He's running. John probably is the disciple of Jesus' love, ran. He looks down, sees there. Peter goes in the tomb. He looks and he sees the grave clothes folded there, which is sort of weird because you're going to be a grave robber. You wouldn't strip the corpse naked and then steal him. So that's sort of weird. And then the scripture says, he saw and believed, for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he may rise from the dead. So the guys got their quick in, out, saw he's gone, went home. Okay? Mary is still in her grief. Mary is still there lingering. She looks into the tomb and she sees two angels. And life is not making sense because she's been there all along. She knows that the disciples saw the empty tomb. And she looks in and she sees these two angels, and what they look like, don't know. And she asks, where's the body? They've taken him. I don't know where they took him. Where's the body? And then she turns away from the angels. And she's Jesus, except she doesn't see that it's Jesus. She thinks that he's the gardener. And one can imagine the desperation in her voice. Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you've laid him, that I might take him away, that I might take possession of the body. She's determined. She's in her grief. And then Jesus calls her by name, Mary. And the light bulb goes off, and what was impossible in her mind was now possible. He who had died was raised to life. It's that personal touch. It's Jesus calling Mary by name, her individual name. And Jesus calls each and every one of you by name as well. When you are baptized, the pastor asks, how are you named? And your parents said, whatever your name is. Or if you're baptized as an adult, I am, John Jacob Jugelheimer Schmidt. And he says, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And so you've got your given name, but you also have God's name placed upon you. And because God places his name upon you, and because he connects with you, where he goes, you go. Where his body is, your body is. As his body was on the cross, somehow, some way beyond our comprehension, your body was on the cross. And as his body was raised again to life, somehow, some way, your body is raised to life. It will be completed. Jesus is meshed with you. There's nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Where's the body? Well, Jesus' body is somehow in each and every one of us. Where is Jesus' body? Well, somehow, some way, Jesus' body is in with and under the bread and wine. And we will take his body, and his healing will go to every cell of our bodies. That foretaste of the great heavenly banquet. Where is Jesus' body? Well, we are the body of Christ, his holy, precious, chosen people, the bride of the bridegroom, connected, Where is the body? The body is wherever Jesus is heard, wherever Jesus is believed. The body is not dead. You are the body. You are very much alive. Living in freedom. Living in forgiveness. Kicking. Breathing. Being Christ's hands and feet and love in the world. No, Jesus is not dead. The body of Christ is very much alive. Feeding the hungry. Clothing the naked. Loving the world around us. Not because of our old selves, but because of Christ. Let us rejoice in our resurrection from the tomb. In Jesus' name, amen. We praise God with our tithes and offerings. Sing stanzas 1, 4, and 5 of Crown of Many Crowns 525.
Thank you.
We rise for the prayer of the church is printed on page 7 of the book. Let us pray for the whole people of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Almighty God the Father, through your only begotten Son, Jesus Christ, you have overcome death and opened the gate of everlasting life to us. Grant that we, who celebrate with joy the day of our Lord's resurrection, may be raised from death of the sin by your life-giving Spirit. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
With humble thanksgiving, we acknowledge how our Lord Jesus became our servant, how he took our place in suffering, and rose again that we may be saved. Lead us to know with joy the gift of forgiveness, new life, and salvation in our daily lives. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift up all who are sick or in need, that they may know the blessing of God's healing and care. We especially raise before you Jacob, Connie, Helen, Mary Sue, Angie, Mardell, Ron, Marilyn, Steve, Lynn, Haley, Cecil, Jean, Kaylee, and all whom we name before you in our hearts. For those who are approaching the end of their earthly lives, and those who mourn loved ones in the sting of death, let them see through the tears of the grave Christ's empty tomb. Faithful hope remains in the resurrection of all flesh as Christ himself has conquered eternal death. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, we rejoice with all who rejoice. We are grateful that Deanne Burkestrand has had such a wonderful recovery, and we continue to commend her into your care. Risen Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, O Lord.
Amen.
Before we approach the table of our Lord to receive him and his victory for us, let us confess our sins to God our Father.
With humble and sincere hearts, we acknowledge before you, O Lord, that we are not the people we ought to be. We have sinned against you and against one another in words and deeds and actions. We confess these sins to you and plead for your mercy through the merits of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us by your Spirit to amend our sinful lives.
Easter changes everything. It is the world's new reality. Still, there are times when we live as if Easter were only a wish. We live too often as if brokenness were the only reality. We live as if the stone had not been rolled away.
Lord God, the Easter reality is all around us, and yet, in spite of the truth of the resurrection, we so often live trapped in brokenness. We are defeated by Satan's temptations, deceived by the world's false hope and lies, and worn down by the battle against our own sinful flesh. Forgive us and renew us, Lord.
Easter declares the great truth, the victory over Satan, the world, and your own flesh has been won. Jesus Christ, who died for you, has risen. Because of Jesus' death and resurrection, our enemies of sin and death have been eternally conquered. You are forgiven from every failure and every sin. Because brokenness and death could not hold Jesus, you are made whole. As a called and ordained servant of Christ, and by his authority, it is my joy and privilege to proclaim the Easter truth and daily joy that you are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he destroyed death. And by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with the angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praise you and saying, Lord our God, King of all creation, for you have had mercy on us, and give your only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. For Christ, the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world, has indeed been sacrificed, and with his blood has redeemed us from sin and death. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and we give thanks, he broke it, and gave it to the disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." In the same way, also took the cup, and we give it thanks. He gave them, saying, "Drink it, all of you. This cup is a new testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of your sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." As often as we eat this bread and drink this blood, drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.
Amen.
Come, Lord Jesus.
O Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, in giving us your body and blood to eat and to drink, you lead us to remember, confess your holy cross and passion, your blessed death, your rest in the tomb, your resurrection from the dead, your ascension to come into heaven, and your coming for the final judgment. So remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
Alleluia, Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Alleluia.
The congregation may be seated. The congregation is invited to rise for the post-communion thanksgiving. This is the day that the Lord has made.
Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
For his steadfast love endures forever.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Gracious God, by this holy communion, you have given us a foretaste of your eternal kingdom, where death will have been defeated, where there will be no more crying or pain or mourning, where all the faithful will be resurrected in Christ. This we glimpse of what you have in store for all creation. We give you thanks and praise. We ask that by your Holy Spirit, our lives would show forth glimpses of your glory through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Heavenly Father, we pray that you would add your blessing upon the meal we are about to receive. We pray that we may grow closer to you and closer to each other. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you in favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Alleluia.
Please be seated. We stand for Clean Hymn 465.